Good evening, everybody. And thank you so much for the dependent arising class or dependent origination, 12 links in the dependent origination class. So today I choose to explain 12 links in the dependent origination because in London right now we are studying about karma. So in order to understand the concept of karma, so first we have to understand ignorance. Related to the ignorance, then we have to understand, we have to know the 12 links dependent or 12 branches of dependent arising. So that's why we always talk about samsara. We always talk about samsara. Actually, we don't know much about what does mean samsara. Say, sakali, existent. That was sakali. Also in the Heart Sutra, just we recite, you know, they say, it also mentioned the 12 links in the dependent or 12 branches of dependent origination. The practice of 12 links or 12 branches dependent arising is very important practice. It is common practice of Theravada practitioner and Mahayana practitioner as well as Vajrayana practitioner. All Buddhist, you know, practitioner, they have to practice the 12 branches dependent arising. When you practice, when you meditate on 12 links interdependence, then you're going to know how we were born, how we will born, how we control, you know, rebirth, how we control to rebirth in the lower realms, how we can, you know, able to reborn in the, you know, higher realms. We should not think, you know, we can reborn in the lower realm because just only karma, just negative karma. So this concept is very important. Also, when you meditate on 12 links dependent arising, then for you very easy to cultivate renunciation. Because you can see, you know, you have been born, you know, in a higher realm, lower, like millions of years. If you don't cut the root of the samsara, if you don't, you know, cut the second existence, so we will reborn again, maybe, you know, unlessly. So after you study 12 links dependent, now then you're going to know how, where you have to cut, how you can cut the root of the, you know, cyclic existence or samsara. But behind the, you know, story about the dependent arising 12 links or 12 branch dependent arising was, at the Buddha lifetime there was a king, Magadha. Is, I think now we can call around Bodh Gaya. So in ancient time they called Magadha. The king received, you know, very, you know, amazing gift from his friend. So when he opened the gift, it was so, you know, amazing, so expensive, very beautiful. Then the king thought, I should send something, you know, I should return something to the king. But he didn't have a equivalent word, thing which he can send to the king. And he was a little bit, you know, unhappy. So then he, you know, went to meet Buddha, the Shakya Buddha. Then he asked Buddha, so I received a wonderful gift from my friend, but I don't have anything to send equivalent to this gift. Then Buddha asked him to draw the painting about the 12 limbs, you know, or dependent arising, or 12 branches of dependent arising. Then the king asked to, you know, his friend, so I will send you very wonderful gift. You have to be very prepared, you know, king or the lord, so I will send you very big gift, wonderful gift. When he received the gift was so small. He thought, oh, he was just, you know, chasing me, he was just playing with me. This is so small, I don't think it's a so big gift. anyway, just talk there, why not just open the gift? When he opened, he just is painting. So he put, you know, hang up the painting on the wall, and he was just looking at the painting for maybe a few hours, like the whole night. What does it mean, this painting? Within one night, he understood the you know, the measure of samsara. Within one night, he understood, you know, he realized the four truths. Then he become, you know, Arya. Arya. So this is the story of behind the training independence. Also, according to, I think, Tibetan tradition, also according to Vinaya tradition, is mentioned very clearly. All the monastic, you know, institute, all the monastic or temple, you must go the 12 links dependent arising, you know, out of the temple. When someone come to see temple, someone visit the temple first, you can see this painting. It's very common painting in Tibetan tradition. Also in my village, there are so many painting about the 12 links dependent arising. So it's very important. That's why, you know, I choose to give short introduction about 12 links dependent arising here, because we are studying about Lamrim, so right now we are studying about karma. So I think everybody has a phone or iPad, just you open and you just search the, you know, get the photo, 12 links dependent arising. We have a phone, you just, you know, click, just, you know, just wheel of samsara. Wheel of samsara. Wheel of samsara. Then we select, I think, same picture. Then we can look at it. Follow same way. This is. Okay, everybody. Get this photo, I think then we can follow the same picture. The wheel of samsara, just, you know, just clicking the image, then you can see so many different, you know, paintings. Explain about the four noble truths. Truth of origin and truth of suffering. Truth of cessation and truth of the path. Alright? So in the middle of the painting, you can see there are three animals. Right? Pig, rooster, and snake in the middle. And in this painting, which I open in my iPad, in this painting, the two animals, the bird and snake, both come out from the pig mouth. Okay, this is one way you can do a painting. Another painting, the pig, you know, catch to the bird, the bird catch to the snake, and snake catch to the pig. It just go around. There are two different ways. You can make the two different way of painting. In the center, the three animals are the symbolic of ignorance. The pig is a symbol of ignorance, snake is on the bird is attachment. The snake is symbol of anger or hatred. Why then, you know, Buddha asked him to put pig as a symbol of ignorance. As a pig, you know, they don't, you know, differentiate much about clean and unclean, clean and dirty. For pig, clean and dirty is same. So pig has a very, you know, strong ignorance about clean and dirty. The dirty is symbol of, you know, the no virtues. So the clean is a symbol of virtues. Unclean or dirty is a symbol of non-virtues. So far we have a very, you know, strong ignorance. So that's why we have a lot of misunderstanding about virtues and non-virtues. Also, we have a very thick ignorance about the reality. The sky is the symbol of emptiness. Sky is symbol of nature. And sky is very important because so there's a sky, there's a space. Due to the space, due to having space, due to the sky, then everything is happened. If there's no space, if there's no sky, nothing happened. The sky is symbol of emptiness. So pig, usually they, you know, cannot see the sky because they always look at the ground, searching food. They never look at up. They never look at the sky, sun. So that's why so far we are, you know, in samsara, so millions of billions of, you know, countless eons we are in samsara. Because we always look at the down. We only look at the samsara. We never look at the emptiness. Then the bird snake both coming from the, you know, pig mouth. This means ignorance produce attachment and anger. How? For example, we have a lot of ignorance about the, you know, phenomena. We have a very ignorant about person. We have a very ignorant about the food and clothes. So that's why we have a very strong desire. When we have a desire, then we have a hatred. So when we have a desire about something, we wish to achieve the things. We want to, you know, use the things. When we achieve, we have a sense of attachment. When we cannot achieve, when we cannot get the things which we really want, then we have a sense of hatred, sense of anger. So that means ignorance is the root of desire and attachment. This is symbol of, you know, origin of suffering. Then the second, you know, in the picture, out of the, you know, center of the three animals, then you can see there's a true, you know, kind of big picture, one with the animal and the black color. On the other side, there's a white and with the human being. A white color is symbolic of non-virtues, negative karma. The white color is symbol of virtues, wholesome action. This means virtues, non-virtues, wholesome, unwholesome. Due to the non-virtuous action, doesn't matter verbal, you know, physical body or mind, but non-virtues lead you into the lower realms. Right? There are honey gods, realms, hell, animals, lower realms. That's why we have to avoid the non-virtues, then we can avoid to reborn in the lower realms. And the white is symbol of the virtues, wholesome. When we accumulate the virtue, you know, wholesome action, the wholesome action lead you to reborn in the human and, you know, higher realms, so like human and God and demigod. So the black and white, the, you know, the three animals are symbol of origin of suffering. Then the six realms, okay, hell, hungry ghost, animal, human, god, and demigods realms are symbol of truth of suffering. Then look at out of the, you know, then you can see the whole wheel, a horse by very scary, very strong man, right? This is symbol of death, symbol of Mara. You can call Mara of death. So this is showing, okay, doesn't matter the being who are in the lower realms, doesn't matter the being who are in the higher realms, they are still controlled by death. Death. We are not able to escape death. We are controlled by death. Then, top of the painting, can you see there's a painting of Buddha, right? And like a pointing somewhere. Pointing where? Pointing, there's a moon, full moon on the left side. Right? A full moon is symbol of, you know, complete in Latin state or nirvana. The Buddha pointing, the pointing is symbol of the path. So this means, you know, if you really want to get out of samsara, you must practice the path. Then you're going to achieve the nirvana, Buddhahood, the complete state, the moon. Also look at the moon and sun. Sun always give us heat. And, you know, heat or, you know, like it gives a sense of hotness. The moon gives a sense of coolness. Okay, this means the moon is symbol of, you know, free from suffering. Is that it also not that, you know, half moon is a full moon, is complete nirvana, like Buddhahood. This means this picture explains you the four truths. So the animals, you know, the black and white color are the origin of suffering. The six realms include the death, Mara, are symbolic of the truth of suffering. The Buddha, the pointing, is the symbol of the path. The moon is symbol of the cessation, that means four noble truths. This will look at the Buddha is, you know, out of the samsara. The moon is out of the samsara. That means they are totally beyond of the samsara. So then the Mara has a either five skull, like skull, right? Five head. Is symbol of impermanence. Impermanence. Also, according to Chinese tradition, Vietnamese tradition, when they recite the Heart Sutra, or they recite any chanting, they always use the wood, right? Right? Like this. The wood is look like shape of the skull. And traditionally, they have to use the bone, this bone, and the human skull. Then, when they touch, it reminds you impermanence and death. Also reminds you suffering. This means, at the top, in the head of the Mara, there are five skull, right? A symbol of impermanence and death. Then look at, when you always remember, yes, the pig, the snake, the bird are symbol of origin of suffering. Where they are within you. You have a pig in your heart, you have a rooster, you have a snake. We are sometimes look like pig. We are totally ignorant about the truth of the nature. We think we know so many things. Actually, we don't know nothing. we are very ignorant people. We are very ignorant. So even though we don't know anything about impermanence, right? We saw someone yesterday, we met someone yesterday, so we met again today. We think the person was which is we met yesterday, which is we have met today. We think the person exactly the same. Actually totally change. So we have an ignorance about impermanence. Then we have an ignorance about the, you know, dependent origination. Because we think things exist independently, inherently, ultimately. Actually, all phenomena exist only dependently, designationally, you know, depend on only causes and condition. So we have an ignorance about everything. Those ignorance. So look at the ignorance, attachment, desire are source of suffering. Then we have a very, you know, complete source of suffering. That's why we are not happy all the time. We're never happy since we born. We always, you know, experience suffering because all the causal condition is within us, within our heart. So now we move, you know, to links. Now you can see the last circle, there are 12 pictures, right? Just, you know, on the left side of the marasa, we just go, you know, the clockwise. Left side of the Mara mouth, you can see one old man walking towards, depending on what, walking stick. This means the old man, you know, using the walking stick is mean, is symbolic, is mean that the man is blind. They cannot see the world, they cannot see good and bad. That means the old man walking with the walking stick is a symbol of ignorance. Ignorance. So far, you know, we have been hearing about ignorance. We always talk about ignorance. Actually, we don't know much about the definition of ignorance. So ignorance has two meanings according to Buddhist tradition, according to Buddhist schools. How many schools we have in Buddhist traditions? We have a four schools. Okay, usually we have a, you know, Theravada tradition, Mahayana tradition. Within the Mahayana, there's a Mahayana Sudrayana tradition, Mahayana Vajrayana tradition. Okay, we have only two traditions, but we have a four schools. The four schools follow, you know, according to the teaching. The first, you know, the first two school we call the lower school, second two school we call the upper school. So according to the first two schools, the ignorance means know nothing. We have our mind, we just know nothing, it's totally darkness. This is the, you know, kind of meaning of ignorance. But the upper school, ignorance, in Tibetan language we call maripa, ma. It means like, you know, ma, like a kind of, because of how it's kind of, ma is, means a mind. But how we can Chinese like mayo, right? Mayo. The may is a stop something, mayo. It stop the, yes, right? Maripa means the opposite of the wisdom. Opposite of the wisdom. Within the six praja paramita, you know, the wisdom paramita. The wisdom paramita precede the reality, precede the emptiness, precede the selflessness. The ignorance is opposite. The ignorant perceive, you know, independent phenomena, inherent phenomena, permanent phenomena, That means ignorant doesn't mean know nothing. They perceive in the opposite one. For example, this table is impermanent. There's a wisdom which is able to see the table is impermanent. There's another mind which is we have. We can see, we perceive this table is look like a permanent. The ignorant doesn't mean know nothing. It's perceived, but it's perceived opposite one. Ignorance. The second picture, what you can see in the picture, in the painting, what you can see. First is here, right? One old man walking, depend on the stick, because this person is blind, ignorance. The person don't know the truth. In second picture, what you can see? Potter making pot. Okay, it's just potter. Potter is the potter making a pot. Look at the pot become turn, you know, good, you know, beautiful, ugly. It depend what is depend on the person knowledge, the person motivation. Okay, the person has a really good motivation, the person has a good knowledge, the person can make a beautiful pot. But the person doesn't have a good knowledge, the person don't know how to make the pot, the person made a very ugly pot. This means you have an ignorance, you don't know how to make the pot. You don't know exactly how to accumulate the merit. That's why due to the ignorance, we accumulate, the beautiful, we made beautiful pot, we made an ugly pot. This means the pot is symbol of, a karma. Karma. The person is symbol of kind of motivation. If you have a good motivation, if you have a good knowledge how to make a pot, you can make a good pot, beautiful pot. That means you accumulate the positive karma. If you don't have a knowledge how to make a pot, you can make a very ugly pot. Then you can accumulate the negative karma. The pot is the symbol of the karma, the second branch. First ignorance, second is karma. Okay, so ignorance has a two level. Ignorance of person, ignorance of the phenomena. Because we have a selflessness of phenomena, selflessness of person. We have an emptiness of person, emptiness of the phenomena. That means there are two kind of emptiness, then there are two types of ignorance. So within the two ignorance, first, for example, Chandrabhidhi said, when you have a misperception about I, then all things which belong to you, you have a misunderstanding of possession. This is talking about the two ignorance. Ignorance of the person, ignorance of the phenomena. Phenomena include everything except the being. If person is not referred to only the human, it's all being. Then karma, is not just one. We have a positive in terms of the aspect. There are three karma. Positive karma, negative karma, neutral karma. Okay? The positive and negative and neutral karma determined by only the motivation. Then also we have three types of another karma. In positive karma has three types. Once you accumulate the positive karma this life, you can experience the result this life. You accumulate a karma this life, you can experience the result next life. You accumulate a karma this life, you're going to experience the result maybe many years after. And the negative karma same. You accumulate negative karma this year, you can experience the suffering this life. You accumulate negative karma this life, you're going to experience the result next life. Or after next life. And also related to the karma is very interesting, okay? Because generally, even though right now we are born as a human, we born as a human due to the, you know, positive karma. You know, the positive karma throw us as a human. For example, just imagine in the last, you know, in the previous life, we everybody were animal, cow. Somehow, due to the, you know, our karma, the positive karma, they throw us into human life. So we are human being. Even though we are human being, within our life, sometimes we are happy, sometimes we are not happy, sometimes we have a lot of suffering, sometimes we have a lot of problems. That means every moment, we are human being is thrown by the positive karma. It doesn't mean our life is completely ending by a positive karma. That's why sometimes we experience the result of the positive karma, sometimes we experience the karma of the experience result of the negative karma. For example, someone you know, just born as a human, since they are born until their death, they are totally in misery. They are totally in suffering. That's mean, you know, they throw by positive karma as a human being, their life is completely end by negative karma. Some, you know, like another animals, they throw as an animal by the negative karma. Due to negative karma, they were born as an animal. Due to the some positive karma, their life ending and complete by the positive karma. Like you can see, you know, very you know rich people has a very beautiful dog. You don't use dog; they say pet, like cats, dog. They were animal. They were born as an animal due to the positive negative karma. Their life is complete by positive karma. Always enjoy it, but they don't need to worry about food, clothing, somebody feed, somebody wash, somebody clean, somebody bring it for a walk. That means the life's ending by positive karma. That's why many people thought, you know, why is this happened for me? I have been practice Buddhism. I believe into Buddha, Dharma, Sangha. I make an offering every day, but I have always problem, always suffering. That's why you lose belief into Dharma. No, because you are born as a human being, but your life is, you know, complete by negative karma. It is not the reason because you believe of Buddha, Dharma, due to that, you have a suffering, you have a problem. So you can see somebody always doing a lot of negative things, a lot of bad things in the society. They have a very successful life, very smooth life. Because they are, you know, experience the previous karma. So we have a karma, you know, positive, negative, how to end it. Then, in the third picture, what you can see a monkey, right? A monkey. So monkey jumping one tree to another tree, another tree, another tree. That means the monkey is symbol of consciousness. Also destruction. Then ignorance is the, you know, kind of the basis. Due to ignorance, we accumulate karma. Where we accumulate the karma, where we store the karma, we store into the consciousness. The consciousness. Then the monkey jumped from this tree to another tree. So our consciousness transfer from previous life to this life to next life. Next step to upper next life. Our mind is looked like monkey. Monkey never stay very quietly, you know, they're always doing something. They're eating, you know, crashing, jumping, playing. So this means our mind is, you know, not tamed. Our mind is very wild mind. So in order to have a happy life, in order to have a peaceful life, so we have to train our mind like a monkey. Because the monkey had to jump from here to there, there to there. Because the monkey has a very strong desire. The monkey has a lot of destruction mind. That's mean ignorance is the basis. Due to ignorance, we accumulate karma. the karma has a positive, negative, it depends on the motivation. The pot turned as a beautiful, turned as a ugly, it depends on the person how to make. Then the karma, after we accumulate karma, the karma is stored in where? Stored in the consciousness. Consciousness. So here related to the another four schools. First two school, you know, they say that positive or negative karma stored into six consciousness. So we have a six mind. Within the six, five is the five senses mind. They are very, you know, temporal. We cannot store the karma into the five minds. We have to store into six mind. Then according to Chitta Mantra school, the karma have to store into where? All basis mind. All basis mind. Then according to the, you know, the Madhyamaka school, they don't accept the, you know, all basis mind. Even though they don't accept the karma stored into the, you know, consciousness. And the Madhyamaka said, we don't need the store, you know, like a storeroom. For example, this table made of what? Made of wood. Before the wood thrown as a table, it was a piece of wood. Somebody cut the tree. Right? Cut the tree changed as a wood. Somebody destroyed the wood, changed the wood, put it as a table. After we, you know, bake the table, burn in the fire, that wood, the table become dust. Then it's going to atom. Yes, they don't need to, you know, really store room, look at store. You can store all the, you know, positive, negative karma. It's, you know, the previous karma transform as a, you know, this life karma. This life karma transform as a next life karma. Madhyamaka say, we don't need a kind of place to store all the karma. Okay, the monkey is symbol of the consciousness, which is, you know, carry the potency or the karma. So in the show, karma has two different types. One is just consciousness. Second, the consciousness transformed as a, you know, imprint or potency. The fourth picture, what you can see? Boat. In the boat, there are human. They are sailing the boat. Okay. First, ignorance. Number two is karma. Number three is consciousness. Number four is name and form. Name and form. Okay. The boat is symbolic of the form. Form means in a physical body. Name, the person in the boat who's sailing the boat. These are the symbol of name. Form and name. What we have to call form and name? Formless realms, they don't have a form. They have only the name, which is the, you know, four aggregates. They don't have the five aggregates. Within the five, the four are look like person in the boat. Then form is the look like the boat. We call name and form. That means look at you ignorance, you have ignorance, due to ignorance, you accumulate karma. The accumulate the karma is stored into the consciousness. After you store there, then they say then you death. Then what? Then when you rebirth, when you take a rebirth first time, that we are human, right? That's we are human. So next when we death, after we death, we go to next life. When we go to next step, first what we have, we will have a form and name. That means we don't have a I consciousness. Only the as of desire realm, we have a, you know, five aggregates. Within the five, the form is look like Bob. The consciousness, the five aggregates, four aggregates look like the person who's sailing the Bob. That's a look at our physical body. Moving from here to there to here is moving by whom? Moving by the motivation, consciousness, special for the four aggregates. Okay, name and form. 1, 2, 3, 4. The feet, what you can see, house. In the picture, can you see house? Right? Usually the house must have a, you know, 6 or 5 window. Now you can see like a door, I'm not sure, but let's say 5 window or 6 window. That means the first time when we enter into mother womb, the first day, okay, the first day when we enter into mother womb, we have a form, which is, you know, the genes come from parents. Within that very tiny genes, it's smaller than your normal atom. Within the small tiny particle, inside there are 4 aggregates. What are the 4 aggregates? First, can you count the 5 aggregates?
Form, feeling.
Form, this form, feeling, discrimination, consciousness,
compositional factors.
Factor.
The last one is consciousness.
Yeah. Consciousness. You can see the heart sutra, right? Om. Make sure that you can get it. Yeah, deep feeling, discrimination, compositional factor, and consciousness. There's a 5 aggregates also empty. Form, feeling, discrimination, composing factor, and consciousness. These are the 5 aggregates. That means, so next slide, just we hope, you know, we reborn as a human. The first time when we enter into mother womb, that time we have a 5 aggregates. Form, which is the genes come from parents. These are the of that time, these are our form. Within the genes or within the, you know, the concept, there are, you know, 4 aggregates, include feeling, discrimination, compositional factors, and consciousness. That means, you know, name and form. But that time we don't have a, you know, we cannot see the form, we cannot hear the sound, we don't have any kind of, you know, pleasant, unpleasant feeling. Just form and consciousness. Then you can see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. In the picture number 5, you can see a house. House just totally empty, you know, just with the windows and doors. The window and door is talk about the, you know, the, you know, 5 power, sense power, or 6 sense power. If you supposed to have a 6 window. But here we can see, let's say 6 window, yeah, we can see in front, there are 5 window, a side, there's another window, there's a 6 window. The 6 window is symbol of the source, 6 source. Right? That means, number 1, ignorance, number 2, karma, number 3, consciousness, number 4, name and form, number 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 is source. Source means, look at, then first we have a form, then we have a 5 aggregates, and after maybe, usually how many weeks take to give a complete birth? How many weeks? 6. I think I know better than you are. 37 weeks. 37 weeks. Right? 37 weeks. 37. 7 into 37, how many months?
9 months.
9 months, right? 9 months, and actually born is a. Then after 9 months, they will be born. Actually, completely, you know, give a birth, it takes 37 weeks. So it's mentioned very clearly in the Abhidharma. Within the 37 weeks, you know, the first, when the concept time, the consciousness, everything entered into the mother womb. And it gradually, the shape change as a fish, as a frog. Gradually, you know, all the, you know, the shape of eyes that is coming. There's a, we call, you know, five moment of the mother womb. That's mean, like a, I think first is like a fish, then frog, and frog, there's a five moment. Then gradually you can see the eyes, air, nose, slowly develop. Then, you know, five senses is function. That's mean the sixth window is symbol of the source of, you know, sixth mind. Okay, then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, what you can see. You can see, you know, one couple, you know, sleep together, kissing each other. It's a symbol of what? Contact. Six is the contact. Contact. What does mean is contact? Look at, when you are in the mother womb, first you have a very subtle body, you have a five aggregates, gradually then you have a, you know, the six source. Six souls, you have a eyes power, eyes consciousness, but you cannot see the form, you cannot hear the sound. Gradually in the mother womb, then you can see the sound, you can hear the, you know, music, you can hear the sing, you know, singing. That time, the air consciousness have to contact with what? Contact with the sound. There's a sound that you can hear. Then you have a what? You have a feeling. You have a feeling. For example, you have an eye power, you have an eye consciousness. If there's no form, you cannot see. The eye consciousness have to touch to the form. Air consciousness touch to the sound. Nose, small. Smell, tongue, taste, body, texture. Then look at, for example, the sound. When you hear very pleasant music, you are so happy. You have very strong desire, attachment to want to listen the pleasant, you know, music for forever. If somebody stop, you get angry, you get upset, you have an unpleasant feeling. That means whole our life, since we born, we spend our time with the pleasant, unpleasant, pleasant with the attachment, unpleasant with the hatred. Okay, that's a look at the contact. Contact means the five, the six mind have to contact to the object. The five objects is very simple, easy, right? Like the form, sound, smell, taste, texture. What is the object of the sixth mind? Sixth mind. With eye consciousness, you can see form, sound, smell, taste, texture, structure. Then sixth mind, what the object of? Everything. Everything. Okay. All phenomena are object of sixth mind. For example, when you hear the sound, the eye consciousness just perceive the sound. The sixth mind thought, wow, it's so nice. I want to listen continuously. When you have very unpleasant sound, the sixth mind think it's no good, I don't want to hear, don't want to listen. That means all phenomena are object of the sixth mind. Okay, contact mean, you know, the subject have to contact with the object, then you can have a feeling. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. What you can see in the seven picture? Arrow.
Piercing.
Huh?
Piercing.
Yeah. What you call it? Sharp?
Pierced.
Okay. Arrow pierced into eyes. Why not in the body? Why in the eye? Just guess. Seven is showing is talking about what?
Yes.
Talking about pain. Right? Look at it. When I touch, it's so smooth. Oh, it's so nice. It's rough. I have unpleasant feeling. When I touch, then I have a feeling, very strong feeling. For example, if somebody, you know, pick, what do you call it? Poke like a, you know, needle in your body. You say, it's okay. If someone pull in your eyes, you cannot bear. It's so strong, it's so obvious. There's been feeling, you know. The feeling is not pleasant, the feeling is not very obvious. You know, unpleasant, you don't want. Pleasant, you always want. That's why, when you touch to the object, for example, if you go more further, okay, then within the 6 miles, okay, so we have attachment, we have anger, we have hatred, we have ego, we have ignorance. Ignorance usually contact to what? Ignorance always contact to the independent phenomena, inherent phenomena. You just, you know, absorb, just, you know, perceive the permanent thing. This is the, you know, non-existent phenomena. But still they perceive. Second, what is the object of attachment? Desire. What are the object? What is the object of the attachment desire? Let's say, in generally, the beautiful, attractive, the pleasant, the goodness are the object of attachment. Then ugliness, unattractive, you know, these things are object of hatred, object of anger. Then, now you can just think about, sometimes why I have sometimes so strong anger, sometimes so attachment, sometimes so, you know, why we have this thing in our mind? This thing you call, you know, this ignorant attachment, desire, this what we call the innate emotion. Nobody teach us, right? Does anybody teach you how to have an attachment? How to have anger? No. Right? Since we're born, we have. We are not saying it's born with us. We have. We got innate. Nobody teach, because many years we have an experience about attachment, desire, anger, ignorance. We call innate emotion, artificial emotion. So object and subject. When the subject contact the object, then we have a pleasant, unpleasant. Then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Number 8, what you can see. A person is drinking a beer, right? Drinking something. This means when you have pleasant feeling, you don't want to lose the feeling. Right? When you have, you wish to have this pleasant feeling all the time. For example, if you totally drunk, if you are totally drunker, you don't want to stop, you want to drink continuously. Because when you drink, you feel you have a pleasant feeling, you have a sense of happiness. You don't want to lose this sense of pleasant. That's why you keep drinking. So when you have a pleasant feeling, you don't want to lose. When you have an unpleasant feeling, you don't want. You have an attachment to one, you have an attachment don't want. The next picture, what you can see, another monkey. No manga, monkey. Number 9, you can see monkey, no monk, make sure. Monkey you can see in the upper realms, no lower realms. Okay, this is number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, number 9. You can see a monkey, you know, climbs on the tree. What? Look up the fruits. Like, you know, like taking our fruits. Then we call first ignorance. Second is karma. Third is consciousness. Number four is name and form. Then number 5, source. Number six, contact. Number seven, feeling. Number eight, desire. Then number eight, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Number nine, grasping. That means, look at, when you have a desire, so you want to get the things because you have a soul desire. That's in the monkey again, you know, symbol of consciousness, symbol of desire, the monkey collect the fruits. That means, you know, when you are subject connected to the object, you have a feeling. When you have a feeling, then you have a desire. You wish to have a desire, not wish to have a desire. There are two types of desire. One hate, one you know, want. When you have a desire, when the desire stone become very strong, then the desire really act in the, you know, act as a collecting. For example, you know, desire, you can see that how to develop desire. In the, this book, in his words, I mentioned very clearly. The path of the Tibetan Buddhism, the ending, the end of suffering and the discover of the happiness. In the last part, he's talking about the dependent arising. He mentioned very clearly how we cultivate desire for attachment. For example, he mentioned very clearly, for example, when you go to supermarket, you saw kind of appetizement, right? Appetize. About, now it's 8, 7 apple, right? Next one?
Apple 7,
then?
Apple 8.
That's 8. There's a picture, you know, apple 8, $200. Wow, you're so happy, you know, suddenly you wish to buy. That you have just wish to buy, you don't have a really desire. Then after you saw the, you know, the news or the advertisement, you wish to buy, you wish to buy, then the desire getting more strong and strong. Finally, you are able to buy. So before you buy, when you see the picture, you just see the picture, you have a very strong desire about it, but you haven't seen it. Third, when you see in the shop, when you just, you know, look in the phone, the desire stone become very strong. This very become grasping. I really want one, right? Then there's third level of, you know, desire or grasping. Then last, we are able to buy it. When the phone is belong to you, then the desire increase very strongly. Somebody touch, you say, don't touch. It's so expensive. Right? Somebody says, wow, your mobile phone is so nice. Yeah, I buy it yesterday. That's me. You know, but before you buy, after you buy, you have a very different desire. The mobile is same. That's why, you know, the desire, you know, increase very gradually. If somebody asks you, do you like the mobile? Yes, I really like it. Which part of mobile you like it? This cover? No, I like the mobile. Which part? If you just, you know, go, you know, piece by piece, there's nothing, there's not any pieces which you can have very strong desire, attachment. When you open, there's nothing. If you, you know, dismantle all the parts, there's nothing. But look, our mind is very, you know, innocent. Very innocent. That's why when you have a very strong desire about, you know, objects from object, you could think this way, and it indicates your in desire. When you have a desire about, you know, human being, you know, as a person, so male and female, male have a very desire about female have a desire about male. So how we can reduce the attachment desire? How? Same thing, you know, somebody say, one boy said to his friend, I really like her. I always miss her. I really like her. Then his parents asked to him, do you really like her? Yes, I like. Which part of body? Here? No, I like her. No, here, just only here. Face, nose, eyes, mouth, which part? There's not really certain part, right? I can say, I really like this one. If somebody say, I really like your hair, you just keep piece of cut from your head. You can hear it. Right? That's mean, you know, we are very innocent. We are not, we don't have an analytical mind. We just, whatever we see, we hold as a truth, but not really. So it doesn't mean, you know, that the female criticizes the male, male have to criticize the female. So we have to do this kind of analytical meditation in order to reduce the attachment, in order to reduce the desire. For example, when somebody, look, it's a big difference between compassion and love, compassion and attachment. Somebody says, I really have a sense of compassion. Whom? The person. They never say, I have a compassion for their body. Just a person, just a people, just a human being, just a sentient being, right? The compassion always focuses to the just person, not the physical attraction. The desire attachment always focus, you know, the physical quality. It's very obvious. You can see somebody has a very strong desire towards someone. Suddenly, you know, the person got very strong skin disease. Next time when the person see again, he totally lost the desire, lost the attachment. The compassion not like this. The compassion, the people have a more, you know, disease, more suffering, more problem, the compassion can increase more, increase more, increase more, come more closer, come more closer. Attachment, the people become, you know, older, lost the attraction, the mind become, you know, more gap, mind and the person, gap and gap, finally, they don't want to see each other. So there's compassion always focus just the person. Attachment, desire, always focus on the attraction, attractive parts. That's why, you know, when the desires, you know, increase very strongly, you cannot wait, you really want, For example, when you have a very strong desire to eat pizza, nobody can stop you. You have to get pizza. Because the attachment is so strong, that means the monkey, you know, collecting fruits. Okay, then you have a, you know, you contact with the object, you have a feeling, you have a desire, desire increases so strong, then next what? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and the 10th picture, what you can see? Pregnant woman, not pregnant man. Yes, I was very surprised. I saw in India there was a news. A man become pregnant. Also, you know, I think in India, in ancient time, I'm not sure this is a legend or truth story. There was a long story, like one book. There was a monk, you know, he washed his clothes on the basket, on the pots. In the mountain, he was in the meditation, he just stayed in the mountain, he washed his clothes. Then one deer came and drink the water, and the deer became pregnant. And finally the deer gave a birth as a human. Right? Do you believe? Don't you believe? Difficult, right? At the book, it's very mentioned clearly in the Sudarayana, in the Vinayana teacher. There's a two monks, the name was Netanta and Nyanta. And it's translated into Tibetan language from Sanskrit. Tra and Nyanta, two monks named called Tra and Nyanta. Both of them are, you know, of course, a human, but they give birth by, you know, like a Both. Give by birth. Birth. Because ancient time people travel by, you know, boat. On the way, I think the boat, some of the boat got destroyed, and the merchant people just hold the piece of wood. Finally, they reached to the shore of the ocean. Nobody there, no human, only a bird. So somehow they have physical relationship with the bird. They give a birth as a person. So it's a pregnant woman now. So pregnant woman is look like, you know, you have a strong desire and then grasping. Finally, there's a pregnant woman. Pregnant woman is ready to give a birth. That means how we can link, okay, attachment, desire, contact, then feeling, desire, grasping. How we can link with the pregnant woman? How? What's the connection? The pregnant woman is, you know, ready to give a birth. For example, before we, you know, we dead. So somehow we have a, for example, some of you maybe have seen so before in the hospital. Someone stay in the hospital with a, you know, air conditioned room. The room is so cold, very cool, not hot. But the people who are very serious patient, the patient said, I feel so hot. I need some air condition. Air condition totally on, but still feel so hot. That time, the patient who really nearly died, he has a strong attachment, what? Warm, hot, fire. It's strong desire about the hot, like a kind of heat. Then the desire increase more and more, then the desire, you know, push the negative karma more powerful, more powerful. Finally, the karma has become very powerful, then the people will be born as a lower realms. So I hope I can finish. Okay. So the pregnant is symbol of, you know, become the karma is so powerful, very complete. The karma is the positive, if the karma is positive, is very complete. The person will be reborn where? Fortunate realm or, you know, higher realms. If the complete karma is negative, then the person will be reborn where? Lower realms, you know, unfortunate realms. It's ready to give birth, okay? Then next, 10 is what? Number 10, give a birth. Is complete, you know, born in the samsara again. Born. Then number 11, so number 11. The number 12? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Number 12? Aging and death. Aging and death. Okay, aging and death. So aging and death become, you know, together, because there's no linear order. Someone just born 1 minute, second minute, death. There's no really certain guarantee, born and, you know, remains for many years. But in the picture, you can see one man carry what? Carry something. Carry something. What the symbol of the carry? The bird and the things which is carry, what is the meaning? A dead person, yeah, a dead person, or it's just, you know, thing. It's not a dead person. This man is showing, since you're born, you are moving towards death. Since you were born, 1 minute, for example, you know, you born right now, second minute, you are moving towards what? Death. You are moving towards your end of the life. That means you are, you know, death always with you. You are moving towards death. Not only that, we know before you know, birth and death, between there, you always have a suffering. You always carry something. If you carry very heavy burden, very luggage, when you take a rest, you are eating, but you feel suffering because you have a burden with you. So that means in samsara, you never be, you know, completely happy. You never have a complete happiness because you are always carry the truth of suffering. The dead body is symbol of the truth of suffering. Also, the dead body is the symbol of, you know, moving towards the death. Okay, now we can call number one, ignorance. Number two, karma. Number three, consciousness. Number four, name and form. Number five, source. Number six, contract. Number seven, feeling. Number eight, desire. Number nine, clinging. Number ten, existence. Or if there's a different word, okay, existence. Or existence, another word, becoming. Becoming. Becoming means the karma becomes very powerful. Then, number 11, so number 11, birth. Number 12, aging and death. Also, aging doesn't mean you, you know, getting old. You know, you move, you know, 1 year to 2 years, 2 years to 3 years. Every year you are getting old. You're getting old. Not really. Aging doesn't mean totally old. We just finished, you know, one kind of set of 12 interdependent. Now within the 12, we can divide into three. Okay, three. Okay, within the 12, three are afflictive emotions. Within the 12, three are afflictive emotions. What are they? Ignorance, desire, clinging. Okay, number one, number eight, number nine are the afflictive emotions. These are the, you know, the root of the samsara. Nyumusumam, lamsum. And true arts, karma. Okay. First, number one, number eight, number nine are the afflictive emotions. Number two, number ten are the karma. Number two is karma. Number ten is becoming or existence. These are the karma. Rest of the seven are suffering. Okay? Within the 12, number one, number eight, number nine are afflictive emotion. These are the source. Due to the ignorance, due to desire, due to attachment, so clinging, then we have a karma. And the karma becomes so strong with becoming. Due to the ignorance, desire, clinging, and karma becoming, then we born in the samsara. Seven are the suffering. That means, subodale nijude. From the three, there are two, which is karma and becoming. Subodale nijude. From the two, the karma and becoming, from karma and becoming arise seven. Let me look at, before death, we have an attachment, we have an ignorance, attachment, desire, we already accumulate karma. Also, before we death, we have a lot of causes condition for next life. That's why we keep, you know, accumulating the positive karma, negative karma. That's why we keep, you know, reborn again and again in samsara. So this is another two sets, another set of trailing independent. Now you just how we can, you know, meditate on the trailing independent. First you have to go through the forwards. That means just imagine there's ignorance. Due to ignorance, we have a desire. There's a two different order. Huh? This order is order of how Buddha teach, how Buddha talk. Actual order is first there's ignorance. We have ignorance about the phenomena, then we have a misunderstanding, misperception about phenomena. Due to the misperception, then we have attachment, we have hatred. Due to the attachment, hatred, then we accumulate karma. First ignorance, desire, grasping, then karma. Karma. This is order how we accumulate karma. We have a karma due to the karma. Then we born, reborn in the samsara. Then, you know, another number come later. Ignorance, desire, grasping, then number second, karma. Due to the karma, then we give a birth. Then we death. Right? It's the order, actual order, how to arise. Clear? Ignorance. Number one, ignorance. Number two, what? Desire. Number three, grasping. Number four, karma. Number five, consciousness and reborn. Then number six, aging and death. This is actual how, you know, we born in samsara. So this is the forwards order. Now we go reverse. In order to avoid the death, what we have to avoid before death? If we couldn't mourn that, could not mourn, we want death. So in order to stop death, first we have to stop what? Born. Reborn. In order to stop reborn, what we have to stop? We have to stop karma. Positive, negative karma. In order to stop karma, what we have to stop? We have to stop desire, grasping. In order to, you know, avoid, in order to eliminate desire and grasping, we have to eliminate what? We have to eliminate ignorance. Okay, there's a true order, how to, you know, arise, how to stop. Then finally you can see somehow, in order to overcome from samsara, in order to overcome from suffering, number one, we have to eliminate ignorance. Ignorance. We have to eliminate ignorance because ignorance is the root of the samsara, root of the suffering. Then the big question, how we can, you know, eliminate ignorance? How? We cannot eliminate ignorance very simply doing some chanting, praying, prostration, making offering mandala, we cannot. We really have to know the opposite of the, you know, how ignorance proceed. For example, when you have a strong anger, you know, strong anger towards Mr. A, when you have a very strong anger towards someone, Mr. A, if you cultivate compassion, Mr. B, it doesn't work. Right? If you have a strong anger towards Mr. A, you must cultivate compassion, tolerance, love towards Mr. A, not Mr. B. That means you have an anger towards Mr. A. If you cultivate compassion towards Mr. B, that means you know the bad spirit in the eastern east. You are throwing the dharma in the west. You must throw the dharma where the bad spirit is there. That means look, you know, when you cultivate compassion towards Mr. A, the anger towards Mr. A is decreasing. Very obvious, very easy to understand. Because the compassion perceives the person is so beautiful, so nice, so good. Anger perceives the person is so ugly, so bad. Right? That means anger and compassion is totally two opposite mental factor. They cannot coexist at the same time in our mind. When the anger arises, compassion decreases. When compassion arises, anger decreases. When ignorance increases, the wisdom decreases. When wisdom increases, ignorance decreases. So we have to know, we have to realize, you know, the nature of all phenomena. We need to know the truth of the phenomena. Once you know the truth of the phenomena, then ignorance automatically going to decrease. That's why, you know, what Narasimha said, even though if you have a doubt about emptiness, even you wish to know emptiness, you wish to realize emptiness, that moment, your ignorance, you know, is shedding. Your ignorance is becoming soft. Just you have a doubt of emptiness. When you realize emptiness, of course, then you know your ignorance becomes totally, you know, small, minor, small and very less powerful. So that's why, whatever we accumulate karma, whatever we do practice, whatever we do chanting, we do practice chanting in order to realize emptiness, in order to understand emptiness. Without understanding emptiness, we should not hope, should not have a hope to overcome suffering, to overcome from samsara, to achieve nirvana. No, you cannot. That's why we have to study about the emptiness. So what here, you know, what does mean emptiness? Emptiness, it doesn't mean nothingness. All phenomena are empty or inherent existence. All phenomena are empty of independent existence. This means, you know, when we look at, you know, someone, we can see that the person is exists from object side, from their own side. That's why we say, oh, you do this, you did this. We just pointing you. That moment we clearly we perceive the person is existing independently. Then you put second thought. Is the person exist independently or dependently? If you think it exists independently, then the person doesn't need any causes condition because it exists independently. You know, dependent causes and condition, we say things are exist, you know, independently. Or on other side, we say things are depend on causes condition. We say it is the contradiction statement. For example, say I am very independent person, but I rely on my parents. It's contradiction statement. Once you rely on your parents, you are not independent. Once you are totally independent, then you are not relying on your parents. Then according to Buddhist philosophy, you know, all conditioned phenomena depend on causes and condition. Conditioned phenomena. All phenomena include permanence, depend on part and partial. There are actually four levels of dependent, meaning of dependent. All four schools accept all, you know, conditioned phenomena depend on causes condition. the first meaning of dependent on cause and condition. The second meaning of, you know, dependent or part and partial. This kind of concept except only the Chittamandala school and the Madhyamaka school, not the first two schools. Okay, part and partial.
The whole.
Part and whole. The third meaning, dependent on basis. Merely basis. This except only Madhyamaka school. The last one is very subtle, but so difficult to understand. It's not really, in the deep down, you are not really comfortable to say. All phenomena merely designation. All phenomena merely only designation. Designated by thoughts and name. Thoughts and terms. That means, you know, look like every phenomena look like a dream. So there are four levels of meaning dependent. Dependent on cause and condition, dependent on part and whole, dependent on the basis, dependent only name and thoughts. The last one is very subtle, is I think we believe is a very, you know, fine meaning of dependent. Here another important, you look at the text name in Tibetan, Tenjin Dewanjua, arise dependently. Arise dependently. So that's why the first time when Buddha talked about the dependent, you know, dependent arise. What he said in the sutra, you know, the people who attend our class, they know, maybe, or which class have you attended before? Huh? That's good. Anyway, what Buddha said, okay, at the Buddha lifetime, there are some non-Buddhist school, non-Buddhist, which is Hindu. Hindu believe in, you know, Bhagwan, like a god. According to Hindu today, except one Hindu school, otherwise all Hindu school except, you know, the creator. They are theistic religion, right? Theistic religion. They believe in God. Everything, you know, creates by God. The God is immortal, permanent. Then how things, you know, created by God? The God has a thought. Due to the thought, wish to be have something is happen. There's a being permanent, has a thought, everything is created by God. They are the theistic religion. Then what Buddha said first time we talk about dependent arise. He said that is exist, that's why this is exist. That is exist, therefore this exists. In Tibetan, Diyuvichir Dijung. So that is exists, therefore this is arise. Okay, very clear. That is exists, therefore this is arise. There is a causal condition, that's why this is arise. We have a suffering because there is causal condition of suffering. We have a happiness because there is a causal condition of the happiness. The happiness only depends on causal condition, not depend on God, not depend on Buddha. Okay? That is exist, therefore this is arise. Second time, that is arise, therefore this is also arise. First moment talking about, you know, condition of power. Condition of power. Because the causal condition have a power to arise something. That's why things are arising. You know, condition power. Second, that is arise. That is arise, therefore this also arise. He's talking about the power of impermanent. The causes, condition are impermanent. That's why the result also impermanent. If the causes, condition permanent, it cannot produce the impermanent things. It's talking about the power of impermanence. First power of condition, second power of impermanence. Third, look at very simple. There's a causes, condition. That's why this the result arises. The causes, condition are impermanence. That's why the result also impermanent. Permanent condition, causing condition cannot produce the permanent product. And third, there's a cause, that's why result. The cause is permanent, that's why the result also impermanent. Then, everything can produce everything? No. They said, for example, ignorance produces karma. This means, in order to produce very particular product, the condition must have a very particular power. Okay, it's totally very important. Once is the condition, power, impermanent power. You have to begin with the first is talking about power non motivation things. Not motivation. Second is a power impermanent. Third is talking about power of the condition. So I think we just stop here. So before we end the class, we have a few minutes. If you have any question, so in the Ramlin class, I think I will explain a little bit continuously about the 12 days independent because I haven't finished completely. So I will explain a bit when we have a Ramlin class. Okay, any question? I'm so happy that everybody know completely, understand completely. That means there's only two options. No nothing or no completely. Yeah.
Ask
yes, yes, please. Very simple, huh?
Yeah, very simple.
Something you confuse me.
What produce bodhicitta?
Oh. What produce bodhicitta? That means bodhicitta produce from what, right?
Yeah.
Okay. According to Buddhist philosophy, we believe in two conditions, right? Primary, secondary. Primary cause, secondary cause. All condition phenomena must have a, two conditions. Condition of the primary, condition of the secondary. For example, the barley seeds. The barley comes from what? Barley seeds. The barley seed is the primary or principal cause of the barley, sapling or barley sprout. Then the water, soil, the people who produce, these are the secondary cause. Bodhicitta, look at, we have a mind. We have mind, the mind always think only consider about yourself, your family, your brother, your sister, your relatives. It never extend for all sentient beings. Then we already have the mind. So the foundation, this mind is the very foundation of bodhicitta. Next, we have to extend. For example, we have a compassion. The compassion you always focus on what? Only me, my friends, my relatives, very small. Then the compassion which we have to extend the compassion for all sentient beings. Bodhicitta, we have a mind, just always consider about yourself, only your family, brother, sister. This mind have to extend for all sentient beings. That means this particular mind produce the bodhicitta. But this mind have to extend. There's a two different way how we could extend. So there's a seven instructions. Seven steps of instruction how to expand the mind. There's another instruction changing self and others. The true using the true methods, then you can produce, if you can extend the mind as a bodhicitta. That means bodhicitta produce from mind, because bodhicitta is mind, not mental factor. great compassion comes are the mental factor, not mind. Yeah, any question? Yes, please.
So I was wondering, can I say that I like good qualities of this person, the qualities like?
Okay. May I ask you a question?
Yes.
Are you talking about quality of mind or quality of body?
Qualities of attitude.
Huh?
Qualities of virtues like generosity, attitude. It's not more of the past.
Okay. Okay, you need to go more precisely. You are not talking about physical body. You are talking about what? Virtues like the doing good thing.
Yeah, yes.
Okay, if you really like someone based on doing good thing, this is not really attachment. It's kind of, you know, positive desire. It's very easy to see, I really love the person because the person has a good mind, wonderful mind. The person always do good thing. Then why not, you know, 10 years girl can like the 80 years old man? Why not, you know, 10 years, let's say 20 years boy, why they really fall in love into 90 years woman? Because the 90 years man and woman has such a wonderful mind, very compassion, very positive, good, but we don't have fall in love. Falling in love always throws what? External attractive. But we are saying, oh, I really don't care the body, I really like the person. We always saying that, you know, I really like the person, I don't care the outlooking. But the saying, actually not. Actually, they are picked on the physical body, the outside attraction. That's why you can see, it's very obvious, you know, sorry to say this way. Because someone fall in love when they are so young, they say, usually say, you know, I cannot live without you. Doesn't matter what they say. Okay, they both of them agree, you know, to marry, live together first few years. Then start to hate. Because you know, the physical out change, or maybe the expectation doesn't help. That's why they divorce. If the people really like, really care, the person itself, they don't care the look, you know, look beautiful, look ugly, they don't care. They just care the person. That's why, you know, the relationship between, you know, couple or boys, girls, you know, the relationship built based on the pure compassion, pure sense of caring, it remains forever. The relationship built on the, you know, the attraction, based on attractive parts, it will lose any time. That's what you are saying, you know, the positive, whatever, if you are saying that, generally saying. Okay, so we stop here, and so we drew the meditation prayers.